Namaskar and very good morning. I am Rajendra Pal from CIT NCRT. You are watching live telecast from Swayam Prabha, channel number 31, Kishore Manch. I have with me Professor D.N. Sansanwal. Professor Sansanwal was a director, School of Education, Devi Ahilya Vishwavidyalaya, Indore. And we already had certain sessions with him. Sir, we have discussed concept of educational research and hypothesis and testing of hypothesis, some part of testing of hypothesis we have already discussed.
Correct.
Today we will be continuing the testing of hypothesis,
yes.
The remaining part of that. And I would like to inform that today especially we will be talking about type 1 error and type 2 error.
Correct.
And one tail test and two tail test.
Correct.
First of all, I will request Professor Sansanwal just repeat certain things which we have already covered.
Correct.
So that viewer are linked with us.
That's right.
Yeah, please.
That's right. Say, we have already covered the concept of degree of freedom. We have also covered the concept of level of significance, and I have already done one example where I have demonstrated how the hypothesis has to be tested. Now, yes. I like to continue with it so that the people start understanding the testing of hypothesis, which is very difficult. So, therefore, I will continue with that. Now, let us take one more example of the objective. Say the example is to compare mean scores of self-efficacy of teachers of primary schools and higher secondary schools.
This is objective.
Yes, this is my objective.
Yeah.
And for this objective, I have formulated the hypothesis. And I have formulated hypothesis in the null form. I have already told that most of the time, we will be formulating hypothesis in the null form because the base which we have that does not help us to formulate hypothesis in the directional form. So, the hypothesis in the null form is that there is no significant difference between mean scores of self-efficacy of teachers of primary schools and higher secondary schools.
Sir, also tell us what type of hypothesis is this?
This type of hypothesis is a statistical hypothesis,
yeah.
Because I have used the word mean.
Okay.
And its form is null.
Yeah.
Because I have used the word null. So,
okay.
Therefore, this is a statistical hypothesis in the null form.
Okay.
Now, let us take the example, and I have taken the data and I have analyzed the data with the help of the SPSS, the statistical package for the social sciences.
Sir, last time when you delivered lecture on hypothesis testing, there was a question from the viewer that what we mean by SPSS.
Correct.
Yeah, please.
This SPSS means it's a statistical package,
okay.
For social sciences.
Okay.
But if you want to know how this package can be used in order to analyze the quantitative data, then for that of course we have to have another session.
Definitely.
Because
definitely.
In this session I can't demonstrate,
yeah.
And there are large number of statistical techniques available, so
okay.
It requires time. So let us understand that this SPSS output which I have got already, it is there, and now we have another output of the SPSS in front of you, and from these output now let us see how do I test the hypothesis. So the testing of the hypothesis goes like this, that the objective was to compare the mean scores of efficacy of teachers of primary schools and higher secondary schools, there were teachers from two types of schools, namely primary and higher secondary schools. So the data were analyzed with the help of t-test, and the results are given in the table number 3, because table number 1 and table number 2, these are the outputs of the SPSS. So therefore, from those outputs I have made a table, and this is the table in front of you. And from this particular table, let us see how do I go ahead with testing of the hypothesis. Now, from this table, it is evident that the t value is 0.05, which is not significant. It means the mean score of self-efficacy of primary school teachers and higher secondary school teachers do not differ significantly. Thus, the null hypothesis that there is no significant difference in mean scores of self-efficacy of primary school teachers and higher secondary school teachers is not rejected. The moment I say is not rejected, this means I have tested the hypothesis. Now, after having tested the hypothesis, now you can go ahead and say what exactly is the finding. So, therefore, it may therefore be said that teachers teaching in the primary and the higher secondary schools were found to have self-efficacy to the same extent. Once I say this, this becomes the finding. And the earlier was when I said that the null hypothesis is not rejected, that is what exactly the testing of the hypothesis.
Sir, one more question from the viewers. The t value in hypothesis, they want what is t value in hypothesis and what is t test.
Okay, say t test is a statistical technique which is used to analyze the data, and t test helps the researcher to compare, to find the significance of difference between the means of the two groups. That is the statistical technique known as t-test. Okay. And this t will give us the value. There will be a t-value. Now, in order to find whether this t-value is significant or not, this t-value has to be compared with the standard value which is given in different books on statistics.
Okay.
That is what is this. Now, we go ahead and whenever we do a research, it is very difficult to have a research without any error.
Okay.
Whenever we test the hypothesis, there has to be error. Okay. And these errors technically are of two types. One is called type 1 error, and another is called type 2 error. And there is a lot of confusion amongst the different researchers as far as the type 1 error and type 2 error is concerned. It is not very difficult to understand. Let me take one example. Say, now I am going to explain the type 1 error, and the example is, suppose the t value is 1.789. and the degree of freedom is 60. Now, this value, if I see in the standard table t-test, I may find that this value is not significant at 0.05 level. I have already explained that the researcher can maximum have the 5% error. Okay. He cannot have more than 5% error. So, therefore, 0.05 is the lowest level of significance. So, therefore, we test it at a lower level first, and then we go on the other side, the upper side. Now, in this case, this t value is not significant. Now, this means that if this t is compared with the t table given under the 0.10 level with df60. Earlier, I had seen a t value given under 0.05 level, and now I say I want to increase the error. Now, in this case, the error is 10%. So, if I increase the error, you can see that the t value comes out to be significant at 0.10 level. That means when the error was 5%, the value was not significant. But when I increase the error, then the calculated value becomes significant. So, that means any calculated value will be significant at some level, and that level will be very, very, very low level. So, therefore, in this particular case, if you see that the statistical calculated value may not be significant at 0.05 level, but it may be significant at a lower level, as just now I have said. Okay. And that lower level in this particular case was 0.10. Now, in this case, the null hypothesis should not be rejected because the t value is not significant, because the standard level of significance is 0.05 level. But now this value is not significant at 0.05 level, but it is significant at 0.10 level. So this is very important to understand, and therefore one can say that in reality the null hypothesis should not be rejected, but the researcher decides to reject it. Now, this is what is called type 1 error. Okay. So, that means any statistical value will be significant at a very, very, very low level. So, you have to be very careful, and that is why there is the lowest level which has been decided, and that should be used by all researcher, and that lowest is 0.05 level. So, therefore, I once again repeat for the benefit of the researchers that in reality the null hypothesis should not be rejected, but the researcher decides to reject it is called type 1 error, or is also called the alpha error. And why he is rejecting? Because he has increased the error, and by increasing the error means he has already lowered the level of significance. By lowering the level of significance and error, I have already told the relationship between them, that higher the error, the low will be the level.
Now, I want to ask a question, whether increasing the error is in the hand of a researcher or it is unknown error.
Actually, whenever the researcher starts doing research, he should decide at what level he wants to test the hypothesis. Okay. Normally, the lowest level is given as 0.05 level. Okay. But this is not so in all subjects. If you see in science, where your instruments are very sensitive, where you have lot of control on many parameters, and therefore there you will like to have error much less than the 5%. So therefore there the people will like to have the level of significance as 0.005 or 0.001, so that the error is less, and it's very important in science. In social science, because most of the things are not within the control of the researcher, so therefore he cannot exercise lot of control, and therefore there are chances of error, and there can be different sources. Say, for example, when the researcher selects a sample from the population. Whatever efforts the researcher may do, it's very difficult to get a sample which truly represents the population, because there is too much heterogeneity in the population.
Error can be from the selection of sample.
This can be from the procedure which we use to select the sample, and is called a sampling error. Mm-hmm. Sometime we know that we have to use the tool. These tools may not be fully reliable. So therefore, some error comes from the tool.
Okay.
Another is when we go in the field and we administer the tools, and if we are collecting data from different places, we may not be really giving the same instruction with the same tone, with the same bent of mind. So all these things, they give rise to error.
It means when a researcher is developing his tool for his own purpose, he is not standardizing the tool, there is a chance of error in the reliability and validity.
That's right, because when the tool is not standardized, so that means its reliability and validities are unknown, and therefore there may be some error from that side.
So it means we can say it is not in the hand of researcher.
No, if the researcher wants, he can reduce the error by using the standardized tools, by following the appropriate sampling technique, going in the systematic manner, but it's very difficult to bring this error to zero.
It's
not possible.
It means even if we take standardized tools, there are always error will be there.
Yes. Because there is always human interaction. So whenever there is a human interaction during the process of the research, there are likely to be some error. And these error are not mistakes, because these error are unintentional. These are not intentionally done, because unintentionally the researcher may say something which he was not aware of, and it may have a very different effect on the students.
Because of that, some of the experts says that no research is possible without error.
That's right. Yeah. So I have explained the type 1 error. So in this type 1 error, now you have understood that although the value is not significant, that means null hypothesis should not have been rejected, but the researcher decides to reject, and when he is doing that, he is increasing the error, and therefore he is lowering the level of significance. Now let us turn to the second, the type 2 error. Now in this type 2 error, let us take one example, and suppose the t value is 2.356 and df is equal to 40. And if you see this particular value in the standard table, and you may find that this value is significant at 0.05 level, but not significant at 0.01 level. Because if a value is significant at a lower level, it is understood it is not significant at a higher level. But if a value is significant at a higher level,
definitely
it is automatically understood it is significant at a lower level. So when it is significant at 0.05 level, then it's possible that it is not significant 0.01 level. So therefore, the statistical, the calculated value may be significant at a lower level, but not at a higher level. Now, so in reality, the null hypothesis should have been rejected, but the researcher decides not to reject it. This is what is called type 2 error or the beta error. So that means there is a difference in the means, but because the researcher wants to have less error, so therefore he has raised the level of significance from 0.05 to 0.01, and he says this value is not significant. In reality, it is significant. So this is what is type 2 error. So that means if a value is significant at 0.05 level, it may not be significant at 0.01 level. So therefore, one can say that type 2 error means that the researcher should not have rejected the null hypothesis, but he decides to reject it, is called type 2 error, or this is called the beta error.
And what is type 1 error in compared to this?
Now, in this particular case, there is no type 1 error.
Okay.
Because the null hypothesis has already been rejected. And by taking the 0.05 as a level of significance. And
it,
we can take 0.05 as
type
a level.
Type 2 error, this researcher cannot decide whether to accept or not.
No, in type 2 error, the level of significance is 0.05.
Okay.
Now, the value is significant at 0.05, but it is not significant at 0.01. So, okay. He says that this value is not significant. In reality, the value is significant, but it is significant at 0.05 level, but not significant at 0.01 level. Okay. That is what exactly the thing. Now, here that in one tail test and two tail test, this is very important. Okay. And as stated earlier, that hypothesis can be formulated either in the null form or in the directional form. Now, whenever the null hypothesis is formulated in the null form, then in that particular case, suppose if I have a 5% error, then this 5% error has to be divided equally. We take a normal probability curve, and all of you have seen the normal probability curve, which is also known as bell-shaped curve. So, in this one, there will be two tails. This 0.05 level error will be equally divided on both the tails.
Okay.
And when I divide this on both the tails and we test the hypothesis, this is what is called the two-tailed test.
This so tail, in, tail means two sides of the
two side, two curve. Tail. Two sides, lower yes, sides yes, on that. Yes. But normally it is called a tail.
Okay.
Okay. So there will be two tails, and in this two tail, the allowed error is equally divided in both the parts. And therefore, on the other hand, when the whole error is kept only on one side of the tail, if it is 5%, earlier we divided 5% by 2, so it was 0.025 and 0.025. Now, in this case, 5%, the whole error has to be kept on only one side of the tail. And when you do that, that is what is called one-tailed test. And in this particular case, that at the time of testing the hypothesis, the null form, in the null form, one has to compare the calculated value with the table value given under 0.05 and 0.01 for the two tail test. The values are separately given for two tail test as well as for one tail test.
Oh, on okay. What basis we decide whether it should be one tail test or two tail test?
Say, whenever you have formulated hypothesis in the null form,
okay,
you have to test by using two tail test.
Okay.
But whenever you formulate hypothesis in the directional form, then you have to use the one tail test only.
Whenever we have a direction, we can go that side.
Correct.
If we don't have a direction,
correct,
we have to go both the sides.
That's right. Okay. That's right.
Okay.
That is the, I think, easy way to understand the difference between one tail test and two tail test.
Okay.
And let me tell viewers that most of the time we do formulate hypothesis in the null form because we do not have a very strong base to give the direction. So, most of the time we use a two-tailed test.
Now, I have a question. When we have a very strong base for formulating, do we need to conduct the research or
Yes, see, research we have to conduct, because when if I have already said that whenever we have the large number of the researches, okay, and if there is a consistency in the findings, then there is no sense of continuing with the same research,
okay,
because you can generalize. But whenever you have a large number of researches,
okay,
and you analyze them, uh-huh, and you find that some researches say something, some research findings say something else,
okay,
because of this inconsistency,
okay,
so we, if majority of the findings of the researches give the finding of a particular type in comparison to the very less number of the researches, here we can give direction. Or if there is a base,
okay,
theory as a base, if theory as a base, then in that case we cannot formulate hypothesis in the null form, it has to be in the directional form.
In fact, some of the experts also say that in real sense generalization does not exist.
Correct.
As far as social science and educational research are concerned.
Yes. So, therefore, we have to have a null form of the hypothesis.
Definitely.
Now, so therefore, now in the hypothesis, the formulation in the directional form, one should compare the computed value with the value given under one tail test. And these values are given in the standard books, which I have already said, and
okay,
I have. But it is important to note that the formula used for calculation will be the same. When you are using the t-test when you use, whether you want to use one tail test or two tail test, the formula will not differ. Formula will remain same. What will differ when you have a t-value and when you compare this t-value with a standard value? The standard value will change.
Okay.
That is the only difference which you have, others are not there. Now, here I have for you some of the values which are for the two tail tables, and these I have taken for few DF. If DF is equal to 19 and if the level of significance is 0.05 level and 0.01 level, when DF is 19, then under 0.05 level, the value is 2.093, but
okay,
under 0.01, it is higher. Why it is higher? Because error is less. When error is less, then reality comes up, the purity comes up. So, these are the values which you see in the two tail test. Now, if you see the values in the one tail test, if you see in the one tail test, then you can find out for the same DF, when DF is 19 and the level is 0.05, here it is 1.729. Now, this value is very different from the earlier value. Earlier value was higher, and if you see 0.01, then it is 2.539 when DF is 19. In the two tail test, this value was higher than this. So, therefore, and that makes the one tailed values will always be lower than the two tailed values, because in the two tailed you are dividing the error in the two parts, but in the one tail you are keeping the error on only on one side of that. This is very important, which all researcher should try to understand it.
Sir, we have very less time now.
Go
so
ahead.
I would like to ask you to repeat quickly about one tail test, two tail test.
One tail test is to be used when you have formulated a directional hypothesis, and two tail test is to be used when you have formulated a null hypothesis.
Okay.
That is in short.
And the type 1 error and type 2 error?
In type 1 error, what happens that the statistical value which you have calculated in fact is not significant, but the researcher decides that it is significant and he rejects the null hypothesis, when in reality null hypothesis should not have been rejected. But in two, it is that when null hypothesis should have been rejected, but the researcher decides not to reject it, this is called type 2 error.
And thank you very much, sir. I hope that our viewers must have learned so many things regarding the hypothesis testing, concept of research, and level of significant different errors in the test hypothesis testing. And any query, questions related to today's presentation or previous presentation, I think our toll free number is available for them, and our email address is also given, and they can ask their queries and questions, and definitely we would like to respond even in the future programs. Today we have also responded some of the queries raised by the viewers through our YouTube channel, and we are always ready to respond them. Thank you very much, sir, for giving your valuable time for presenting, and hope in future you will also give your time for our
program.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.